Hey, if you all look down in that direction, you will see a clumping of rocks known in history now as Devil's Den. Pickles will decide that that's going to be in front of Little Round Top, but that will serve as the anchor for his line, and he will move some of his men from that position. That's the anchor going down into the rough ground, back up at an angle back towards the Peach Orchard. And it's kind of hard to see the Peach Orchard proper, but if you look through the gap, roughly in that direction, imagine that where the Wheatfield Road intersects with the Emmitsburg Road on that high ground. That's roughly where it is. But immediately just to get that one connection, you will have to take the first division of the Third Corps and stretch it to the point that it actually breaks in a couple places, so that his three brigades of that first division will be able to stand on a roughly straight line to be able to do that. One of the things about a quote-unquote real-time program on the anniversary of the battle 155 years after the effect is that we try and get these things in a flexible way so that you can go from one to the other without spending the amount of time at each particular event. So we're going to have to amputate several facts of this particular thing without giving it the total justice it deserves. Warren goes back, tries to find the proper fellow in the chain of command for the 5th Corps. The word trickles down to a fellow by the name of Strong Vincent, who is, in spite of his predisposition amongst the modern era. How many of you folks have a positive impression on lawyers, unless you are one? Strong Vincent is a very sharp lawyer. Goes to Trinity College in Connecticut and then finishes up at Harvard. So when he gets this sense that there's something in the air, he manages to hijack a messenger and says, what's going on? Realizes the crisis at hand, gets the sense that he needs to move his brigade of soldiers to this particular place, does so, throws them out onto the southwest face of Little Round Top just in time to receive the advance of the Confederates, who have moved from 3/4 of a mile to the southwest, coming in this direction. And his particular brigade is only a relatively small force in the face of the Confederate attack overall. But that Confederate attack extends across the Emmitsburg Road and has come 28 miles in 11 hours to get here before launching their attack in weather not terribly dissimilar than this. They will send about 22 guys out looking for water at Plum Run, and all of those guys with canteens will become prisoners. They will get caught.
Mm. Oh boy.
So the guys getting ready to launch that attack will deprive all of the rest of those Confederates of the chance to do what many of you are doing with those crinkling little bottles.
Drinking.
And they are wearing long cotton shirts, long woolen jackets, and the ones on the end of the line, the guys in the 15th Alabama, will wind up actually having to climb Big Round Top, which is back over there. And one of the things about having this job is they say, you want to talk about something, you got to go do it. And so we get to climb Big Round Top when we first get this job, sling a musket over your shoulders, and then you have to use all four appendages to do that. Get off the top, go across the top. There's a stunning view of Route 15 from the top of there, and then descend, and that takes you a while. And those exhausted Confederate soldiers wound up, when they got up there, having their minds twisted a little bit, thinking, wow, this is a marvelous place to defend, until a message from their officer tells them, you're not here to defend anything, you're here to attack. And it is in that time frame that Vincent's troops managed to get themselves positioned in this way down here. At the end of Vincent's brigade would be the 20th Maine, the 83rd Pennsylvania, the 44th New York, and the 16th Michigan. And all of those guys will position themselves about halfway up, halfway down, the military crest, as they call it, of southwest Little Round Top. And as they begin to do that, it's going to be a critical moment for the Federals here. And you can all thank Governor Kimball Warren and Strong Vincent for that. But when they begin to get into position here, it's going to have a rather interesting effect. Now, of course, when the Confederates do begin to actually descend here, battle noises have already begun to take place over to the east, because without a big rock obstacle like Big Round Top, they're already beginning to press into Devil's Den and the Valley of Death to their east, or to their west, actually, over here to their right. And so those noises will begin to generate pressure. And as that happens, some of those Confederates, some of the Texan units, will actually begin to sweep up the face to the right. So as we begin to explore a little bit of what's going on here, it's not quiet over here. There are noises of battle, puffs of smoke, yells, shrieks, all that good stuff going on over to the right. Mm-hmm. Now, everybody may be familiar with that good old Gettysburg movie and the continual cinematic enshrining of Joshua Chamberlain. There is other stuff going on over here for the rest of the world. Finally, do begin to come down the slope of Big Round Top. Over here, there's going to be some considerable stuff that's going to take place. And one of the other things that folks always bring up here is the clash of cultures, if you will, that takes place over here. Now, Joshua Chamberlain, who is he? What's his background?
Academic professor.
Anybody know about the background of the guy that's leading the 15th Alabama?
He almost killed a guy, right?
He almost killed a guy, yes. Not to say that academics don't do that on occasion, but, tavern fighter. Yeah, that's what you do on a Saturday night. You go into a tavern, occasionally wail a hatchet around, and the only way he found out that he hadn't killed a guy was his brother went back out of the state, told him it's safe to come back, that the guy actually didn't die. But both of these guys have loyal brothers, and both of them will eventually see the power of higher education and will eventually wind up becoming governors of their respective states. Interesting little thing. But they will both have loyal brothers out here in the middle of this hall. But one of the jobs of the Alabama troops, when they begin to descend out here, they know that the 20-town road is right off in that direction. They know that if they continue pressing around here, they might be able to seize the road. And one of the joys in an army is if you be able to get up the road in the rear of an army, you've got the supply wagons, you've got all those joys of getting into the rear of an army. All the unprepared folks, all the reserves, all the supplies, all that good stuff. And that's what hopefully they might be able to do. So they're determined to sniff around. And of course, the 20th Maine is the last unit out here. They've been told they're the last unit. They've got to hold that line. And so Chamberlain has to take his battle position, two ranks of men, and he will try and multiply that out a little bit. And of course, if we are here at this point, we're already going down the slope. So what he will wind up doing is pulling from the center of his unit. If you look right down there, you'll be able to see the monument for the 20th Maine. That marks the color company, where the flags would have been, in the center of the unit. And he will take from the center and from the center down to the far left flank and pull those guys out into one line, giving them a little more length. But that only works for a while till the Confederates come out and sniff around the back there. But he also knows a little bit about geography. If you begin to wing that back up, you'll be able to make the Confederates work harder and harder. And remember, these are the Confederates that have gone how long, how far?
27 miles.
28 miles in 11 hours. Very good. And they will begin to get more exhausted and more exhausted as they swing back and forth. But of course, for the Federals, it's good to have bullets. And in continual fight, you're issued 40 rounds in your cartridge box and an extra 20 in your pockets when you begin to go into battle. And they just don't have any more than that. So they begin to go over here, because that little marker on the end of the line over there marks where they shake hands with the 83rd Pennsylvania. And they try and borrow a couple bullets from those guys. But they're in the middle of a fight, too, against the guys from Alabama, the 47th over here. And they don't have any more to spare. So they start looking in the pockets and the cartridge boxes of the wounded and the dead. And eventually that will all play out. And we know how this ends over here with the use of the bayonet and the swinging back by the 20th of the Confederates back in that direction. But of course, Oates will do the same thing that Chamberlain does. He will live a long life. He will wind up writing a book about his experiences, and he will become governor. And so one of the things that he will share later on is his opinion of just exactly what happens. And it's a rather interesting one, because he will tell you a slightly different version of what happened. Because he's isolated from the rest of the Confederates coming around this way, and he will say this. He will say, "I found capturing Little Round Top too great for my regiment unsupported. The historian of the 20th Maine claims that its charge drove us from the field. This is not true. I ordered the retreat. He was, I believe, the chaplain and not present to see it. Doubtless he was at prayer a safe distance in the rear. Colonel Chamberlain believed it, but I ordered the retreat. When the signal was given, we ran like a herd of wild cattle." So from widely differing opinions, they come to a similar taproot that is the truth on both sides. So at any rate, they wind up crawling back in that direction. Now the rest of the fight at Little Round Top is taking place on its western face. So we need to get a good look at that before we let you go. So let's head back up this direction. Now the monument, you see if the sweat has already killed on my speaker box here. So these things are not waterproof. Yeah, we may go maybe about 50 minutes here, but I'm going to try and wrap this up. FDR's voice comes over this thing, I'm leaving. By this time, the Confederates are flooding over the rocks that you see down below you there. They've swept over Devil's Den, and they are beginning to attempt to come up the more western space of Little Round Top as it projects to my left and my forward here. There's a very serious threat to the federal position here, because Vincent's brigade is closed off with the 16th Michigan, that small monument you see there on the rock right down there. So they need, the Federals need troops coming up in this direction. And Stephen Weed's brigade will come from the east, coming down this direction here, coming from the Wheatfield Road, coming down at an angle like this to join up to try and push forward. And the 140th New York will push forward down through here, trying to link up with that. They will also bring with them another battery of artillery. Now you saw those guns that we walked past on our way down. That's Battery D-50S. And those guns will begin to try and take a position as soon as they can get clear of the infantry that's in their front, trying to link up with Vincent's people here. But as the Confederates continue to swarm over the hill that you see down in front of you there, they are beginning to make themselves at home, and they are beginning to set up sniper's nests down in that area. Stephen Weed, Charles Hazlett, and Paddy O'Rourke. Paddy O'Rourke being the commander of the 140th, Stephen Weed, the brigade commander, moving his brigade into position here, and Charles Hazlett, the battery commander of that artillery, will all be picked off by snipers as they nestle into the position down in Devil's Den. Now the fellow commanding the artillery that originally fired that shot at Warren's request had been waiting for something to happen up here. He's already lost three guns as the Confederates swarm over that position, and he says the first shot fired by artillery up on this crest was music to his ears. And the artillery will continue to pound Devil's Den and indicate to everyone there that the Federals will hold this as an anchor. They will continue to plink away at various persons of note and of not note, that is to say your common enlisted types, up through here. But as far as the effectiveness of the artillery up here, one Confederate will comment, it was only necessary to expose a hand to obtain a furlough. Little Round Top will be safe and in the Federal hands. The Confederates will retain Devil's Den, but it will be of precious little use to them. The Federals, with the arrival of Stephen Weed's brigade and more Federals along this way, will continue to build an anchor all the way back to the Pennsylvania Memorial, all the way back to the center of Cemetery Ridge, all the way back to Cemetery Hill. And with the arrival of more than just a portion of the 2nd Corps, more of the 5th Corps coming in, they will be able to refill most of the valley here. And with a great deal of blood and treasure, they will be able to recompensate for Sickles' egregious mistake on the midday. And Little Round Top will again be an anchor on the Federal left. And they will be able to utilize this high ground with artillery on the 3rd, when that barn with the 3 spires on it will be a problem for the Confederates as they move from far left, that tree line again, as the Confederates come out with their 15,000 men moving from left to right in Pickett's charge, and the artillery of now, once Hazlitt's battery, will fire from these positions and begin to induce many casualties into Pickett's men as they move from left to right towards Cemetery Ridge. That pretty much winds up this program, so you'll need to go from here down towards Devil's Den to continue.